예, 이제 마지막 강연이네요. 세 번째 강연을 해주실 강연자를 소개해드리겠습니다. 바로 올해 노벨 생리의학상 수상자이신 윌리엄 케일린 교수님입니다. 모두 큰 박수로 환영해 주시기 바랍니다. 교수님 반갑습니다.
Thank you. Thank you.
네, 지금 서로 이렇게 대화가 되고 있습니다. 전 한국어로 하고요. 교수님은 영어로 하겠습니다. 지금 아마 굉장히 바쁜 시기를 보내고 계실 텐데요. 이렇게 한국을 찾아와 주셔서 감사합니다.
You're very welcome.
네, 노벨상을 수상하고 이제 한 달 정도가 지났습니다. 한 달 전으로 돌아가서 교수님께서는 노벨상 발표 직전에 어떤 마음이셨나요? 솔직히 이번에 내가 노벨상을 타지 않을까 뭐 그런 생각은 해보셨었나요?
Well, I will admit I did think it was possible. I tried to ignore, frankly, the Nobel Prize because I think it's better to focus on your work and not dream too much about prizes. But when I did go to bed the night before, I thought there was a small chance I might win.
네, 아주 겸손하게 말씀을 해주셨네요. 자, 그리고 대중의 입장에서 또 궁금한 점이 하나 있습니다. 노벨상 수상 소식을 어떤 경로를 통해서 알게 되나요? 그리고 또 수상 소식을 듣자마자 제일 처음에 가장 먼저 누구한테 이 소식을 알려주셨나요?
Yes, well, actually, I went to sleep the night before, and in my dream, I had a dream that I had not won. I looked at the clock, and in my dream, the time had passed when I should have gotten the phone call. But in my dream, I was very content that I had not won. But then I woke up and saw the clock and realized that this had been a dream and I better go back to sleep. So then I did get the phone call at 4:40 a.m., so very early. And I was, of course, half asleep at that point, and I didn't know whether this was another dream. But this turned out to be for real. And my daughter is a student at Oxford University, so I knew she would be awake, so I contacted her. I tried to reach my son, who's at Harvard, but like most young men, he was sound asleep and didn't have his phone on, so I reached him later. And then my girlfriend, Karen Cantor, she's here someplace, was the next person I reached.
Yeah, 그렇군요. 자, 그리고 교수님은 암을 연구하는 생물학자시라고 들었습니다. 교수님의 연구 분야에 대해서 좀 간단하게 설명을 해주시면 좋겠습니다.
So I was trained as a clinical doctor, as I'll share with you shortly, before I became a researcher. And when I did learn to become a researcher, I decided to focus on specific genes that are actually altered or mutated in cancer and to try to understand their normal functions, and when I started my own laboratory, we began to work on the so-called VHL gene.
네, 그러면 이제 올해 어떤 연구로 노벨 생리의학상을 수상하셨는지 수상자 윌리엄 케일린 교수님께 직접 들어보도록 하겠습니다. 강연 직후에는 윌리엄 케일린 교수님과 대담 시간이 이어지겠습니다. 그때 더 깊은 이야기를 나눠보도록 하겠습니다. 대담에는 이번 케일린 교수님을 초청하시는데 큰 역할을 해주신 서울대학교 이현수 교수님이 함께 하실 예정입니다. 그러면 생명은 산소를 어떻게 감지할까라는 주제로 강연해 주실 윌리엄 케일린 교수님께 뜨거운 박수를 보내주시기 바랍니다.
감사합니다. So when I was in college, I worked in a laboratory for the first time, and my professor gave me a project that was uninteresting, unimportant, and undoable, and I struggled and struggled and struggled, and then in my final week, I told my professor that my project was all based on a mistake and would never be completed, so he rewarded me by giving me a very bad grade. And he told me I should never work in a laboratory again. So I took his advice because I was 17 years old and the professor I thought must be correct. So I went to medical school and I trained to become a clinical doctor. So this is me when I'm 30 years old at Johns Hopkins completing my internal medicine training. And when I was a doctor, I liked learning about unusual and rare diseases, one of which is a disease that we call von Hippel-Lindau disease. It was first described by a German ophthalmologist, Eugen von Hippel, and he had encountered a brother and a sister, both of whom had unusual tumors of their retina, the back of the eye. These were tumors that were proliferations of blood vessels that doctors would refer to as hemangioblastomas. And so he was describing one of the first families that we now would say has von Hippel-Lindau disease. These are patients who have cancer on a hereditary basis. So this came to be known as von Hippel-Lindau disease. So again, this is a cancer that runs in families. It's passed from generation to generation. And it affects about 1 in 35,000 people around the world. It's caused by a defective VHL gene, VHL standing for von Hippel-Lindau. And the classical tumors you see are blood vessel tumors, again, that are referred to as hemangioblastomas, often of the retina, the spinal cord, and also the so-called cerebellum. These patients also develop kidney cancer, and they develop adrenal gland tumors called pheochromocytomas. And I highlight kidney cancer in red because hemangioblastomas are interesting but rare. Pheochromocytomas are interesting but rare. Kidney cancer, however, is actually quite common. And so we thought by studying the VHL gene, we would learn about a common cancer and maybe eventually be able to treat it. Now, before going further, we have to do a brief primer on molecular biology. This is the most complicated slide I'm going to show you. So if we make it through this slide, it's clear sailing. So I think you know that DNA is made up of four building blocks that scientists refer to with the letters A, G, C, or T. And we have about 3 billion of these forming our so-called genome. And the sequence of these four building blocks is a code. There's information in the sequence of those four building blocks. And if a segment of DNA actually contains the instructions for making a protein, we call that a gene. So you can think of a gene as being a blueprint for making a protein. Now, the cells want to protect the original copy of the blueprint, so the blueprint doesn't go to the factory. Instead, cells make copies of the DNA in a form called RNA. And the RNA is basically, you can think of as being almost like a Xerox copy of the instructions in the gene. And the cell marks that these are copies by adding a little tail of these A's here. So you can think of these as being the copies of the blueprint that are going to get sent to the factory floor. Using these instructions, the cell will then make the protein that one can make from this set of instructions. There are four building blocks to DNA, but it turns out there are 20 potential building blocks to proteins. But again, this actual sequence dictates the order in which the building blocks will be assembled to make the protein. Now, what happens in cancers is that specific genes have alterations, or scientists refer to them as mutations, that change the instructions in the blueprint and hence change the nature of the protein that's being produced. So for example, here I'm showing you a segment of the VHL gene where only one change has been made. This ATG is now an ATT. And because of this one mistake out of 3 billion building blocks, now the wrong protein gets made. Instead of the sequence RCL, the sequence is now RFL, where one of the protein building blocks has been changed from a C to an F. And that actually can be life or death for patients, because this is an actual mutation that some patients with von Hippel-Lindau disease carry. And because of this one change, they're at high risk for developing cancer. Now, the last piece of molecular biology I'm going to share with you is that scientists sometimes refer to certain genes being on or certain genes being off. So for example, the genes that have the instructions to make a brain cell will be on in brain cells, but will be off in, for example, liver cells or kidney cells. And so the cell needs a system for turning genes on or off. And that's usually because certain so-called transcription factors can bind to the genes and turn on the Xerox machine and make sure more of the protein gets made. So when scientists say a gene is on or is being expressed, they really mean that copies of the gene are being sent to the factory floor to make more of the protein, whereas if the gene isn't needed, the gene is silent and the Xerox machine stays off. Okay, so now back to my clinical training. So it was known by clinical doctors that the tumors that VHL patients develop are very rich in blood vessels. I've talked about these eye tumors, these hemangioblastomas. Here you're looking at the back of the eye of a patient with von Hippel-Lindau disease. The patient has been injected with a dye that then fills this tumor, because this tumor is just a bag of blood vessels. And likewise, when these patients develop kidney cancers, they start to make too many blood vessels throughout the kidney, and that's because the tumor starts secreting a factor that tricks the body into making more blood vessels so the tumor can get its own blood supply. Now, another curiosity about these tumors that are seen in VHL disease is that they sometimes trick the body into making too many red blood cells. So normally, if you take a patient's blood and you spin it down in a centrifuge, about 50% of the volume should be actual red blood cells. So that's normal. But in patients who have tumors linked to VHL disease, sometimes they start making too many red blood cells. Now, when you spin their blood down in a centrifuge, you can see there are many, many too many red blood cells. So stepping back, the tumors that are seen in von Hippel-Lindau disease can induce new blood vessels, and we know that's because they sometimes produce a hormone called VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor, which you can think of as being sort of like a fertilizer for making new blood vessels. And these tumors also secrete a hormone called erythropoietin, which stimulates the body to make more red blood cells. And what VEGF and erythropoietin have in common is that they're normally induced or expressed when cells and tissues aren't getting enough oxygen. So it seemed like these tumors must have some abnormality in oxygen sensing, that they are behaving like they're always starved of oxygen and they're overproducing the distress signals that cells or tissues would normally produce if they weren't getting enough oxygen. And so that's why we began working on this in hopes that we would learn something about oxygen sensing. Now, I told you about so-called transcription factors. Well, there's a transcription factor that scientists refer to as hypoxia-inducible factor, or HIF, or HIF for short. This transcription factor actually has two components. One's called the alpha component, and one's called the beta component. And when HIF binds to DNA, it can activate transcription of certain genes and gene products that are normally only produced when cells are getting inadequate oxygen, such as the VEGF and the erythropoietin I mentioned a moment ago. And it was known from the work of my fellow awardees, Greg Semenza and Peter Ratcliffe and others, that when cells are getting enough oxygen, normally the HIF alpha subunit is degraded, and therefore HIF is not active. But when cells are not getting enough oxygen, now HIF alpha can accumulate and activate the Xerox machine, if you will, making more VEGF and PDGF and erythropoietin. And so what we went on to show was that the protein made by the VHL gene actually binds to several other proteins, and the names of these proteins doesn't matter, so I've removed them. But basically, this is a sort of a molecular machine that can attach to HIF alpha a little tag that scientists refer to as polyubiquitin. And this little tag marks HIF alpha to be destroyed by a system in the cell that's called the proteasome, but you can think of it as being like a garbage disposal. So when VHL is present, it can bind to HIF alpha, add this tag, and then HIF gets destroyed by the garbage disposal. However, when oxygen levels are very low, or the VHL protein has been mutated or altered, such as happens in certain cancers, now HIF alpha can't be degraded, and so it turns on genes like VEGF and erythropoietin. So this was very satisfying because it told us why loss of VHL would lead to too much HIF and too much VEGF and too much erythropoietin. But as happens often in science, it now raised an even bigger question. How does the VHL protein know whether oxygen is or is not present, and hence whether it's appropriate to destroy HIF alpha? And so what our group showed and Peter Radcliffe's group showed in parallel was that in the presence of oxygen, a little chemical modification occurs on one of these protein building blocks that we represent with a P that stands for proline. But all you need to know is that there's a little chemical modification in the, that occurs on HIF alpha as long as oxygen is present. And even I could see that to make this mark, you would need an oxygen atom, because you can see there's an oxygen right here. Okay, so this generates the binding site then for VHL. And we later identified specific proteins that scientists refer to as enzymes. So enzymes are proteins that do chemical work. And so we found the proteins that actually add this hydroxyl group. And so these effectively act as the oxygen sensing mechanism. So when there's not enough oxygen, these enzymes become inactive, and this mark doesn't get placed, and so HIF is not recognized by VHL. When oxygen is present, these enzymes are active, this mark gets added, and VHL recognizes HIF and destroys it. And about 20 years ago, we showed that these enzymes can actually be inhibited with drug-like molecules, and we thought this might be useful for certain diseases. So for example, there are a number of diseases where you might want to turn on HIF, because the reason we have HIF again is to allow cells and tissues to adapt to low oxygen. And so we imagine that if you took a drug that stabilized HIF, the body would make more red blood cells. That would be good for the treatment of anemia. Maybe this would also be useful for diseases like heart attack and stroke and peripheral vascular disease where there's not good oxygen delivery to tissues. In fact, the tissue damage here in diseases like heart attack and stroke is because there's not enough oxygen being delivered. So we work with a company called FibroGen to develop such inhibitors. It turned out the first people to start taking these inhibitors were professional bicyclists, because they realized they could buy these chemicals as research-grade material from certain chemistry companies around the world, and they started ingesting it, and sure enough, they started making more red blood cells, which is not the way you're supposed to develop drugs, but that's the way it happened here, that the bicyclists were the first patients to be treated. But now the drugs are starting to get approved. The first approval took place in China last year, so here I am watching the pills being made for one of these HIF stabilizers. The drug's now also been approved in Japan, and it's anticipated that the United States submission will occur any day now. Now, there, on the flip side, there are certain diseases where you might want to inhibit HIF, because we now know that certain cancers, especially those kidney cancers where the VHL protein is missing, HIF has been sort of co-opted or hijacked for the tumor's own evil purposes. And so now you can imagine blocking HIF as a way of treating certain cancers. We also know from laboratory studies that a high HIF probably contributes to some other diseases like pulmonary arterial hypertension and fatty liver disease. Now, I showed you a moment ago that amongst the things that HIF regulates is vascular endothelial growth factor. That's that fertilizer that stimulates new blood vessels forming. Fortunately for us, by the 90s, a number of companies, pharmaceutical companies, were already making VEGF inhibitors, and we suggested that maybe these VEGF inhibitors would be useful for the treatment of kidney cancer, and I'm happy to report that that appears to be the case. There are a number now of VEGF inhibitors approved for the treatment of kidney cancer, and so that's been very gratifying, and some patients do well on these drugs for a number of years, but as far as I know, no patient with kidney cancer has ever been actually cured with these drugs, so we need to do better. And one way we thought you could do better was to actually have a drug that targeted HIF to itself. Now, a number of people thought this was not possible, but two very talented scientists, Rick Bruick and Kevin Gardner at the University of Texas Southwestern identified a little pocket within HIF2 that could potentially be used to introduce a drug. And so they've identified chemicals that will bind to HIF2 and will inactivate it. And these drugs are in earlier clinical trials now. They're in phase 2 trials, but they also look very promising for the treatment of kidney cancer. They're also now being used to treat patients with von Hippel-Lindau disease. And so as you can imagine, this is maybe the best place to test such drugs because these patients, again, have inherited a defective version of the VHL gene. They are developing multiple tumors because of loss of the VHL gene, and those tumors are driven by HIF2. So I've been working with a company called Peloton Therapeutics that's developing these HIF2 inhibitors. The data are not going to be officially released for a couple months, but if you're as good at social media as my children are, you can start finding the Facebook pages and social media posts of the patients who are on the trial, and you can clearly see that the drug is probably working because the patients are starting to post their scans online and also are describing how their tumors are shrinking. And I was very touched to see this patient say, "I never thought I would see this day," because these patients have lived their entire life feeling like the so-called sword of Damocles is over their neck because they've seen their parents and their grandparents die of VHL disease, and they just assumed that they would also one day die of this disease. So I think this is really hopefully a game changer now for these unfortunate patients who have taught us so much now about oxygen sensing as well as the molecular basis of certain forms of cancer. So with that, I will thank you very much for your attention.
Yes. 다시 한번 윌리엄 케일린 교수님께 큰 박수 부탁드립니다. Yes. 예, 멋진 강연 잘 들었습니다. 교수님 한국에는 11월 1일에 오셨다고 들었습니다. 혹시 한국에 대한 첫 인상이 어떠셨는지 궁금하고요. 그리고 가장 많이 받은 질문이 무엇이었는지도 궁금합니다.
Okay. Well, first of all, I should immediately point out that I've been very fortunate to have a number of young Korean scientists work in my laboratory over the years. So I already had a bit of an impression about Korea, including Sungwoo Lee, who's in the second row. But actually, in addition, some of the work that led to the Nobel Prize was done by a young Korean scientist. So Korea has its fingerprints on this work. I must say, I'm quite glad that as soon as we arrived in Korea, one of the first things we did was to go to the war museum, because even though as a young child I had heard about the war, when you see how remarkably and quickly this country rebuilt itself, it just filled me with admiration for what has been done here. And so I have even more admiration now for the Korean people. It's just such a remarkable society. And lastly, you won't be surprised that the most common question is, how do you win a Nobel Prize? That's
네, 가장 그래서 많이 받으신 질문은 제가 더 이상 드리지 않겠습니다. 네. 네, 그러면 더 깊은 이야기는 서울대 이현숙 교수님을 모시고 나눠보도록 하겠습니다. 이현숙 교수님께서는 윌리엄 케일린 교수님과 남다른 인연이 있으시다고 들었습니다. 그러면 이현숙 교수님을 박수로 맞이해 주시기 바랍니다.
예, 이런 날이 오네요. 그 저자 직강 그 노벨상 해설 강연을 수상자께서 그것도 시상식 전에 여기 키아스에 오셔서 강연하는 날을 또 제가 중매를 하게 되다니 이런 날이 오네요. 살다 보니까. 예, 저는 서울대학교 생명과학부 이현숙입니다. 예, 저기 이재성 선생님께서 남다른 인연이라고 하셨는데 여기서 명확하게 해야 될 게 있는데요. 제가 이제 동아 사이언스에서의 그 글하고 인터뷰 때문에 뭐 그 제가 무슨 점쟁이처럼 노벨상 맞추는 사람인 줄 아시는데 여기서 좀 제가 좀 고백을 하고 말을 하자면 그 과학자들은 사실 이렇게 모이면 어떤 사람이 노벨상을 받을까 전에 어떤 필드가 노벨상을 받을까를 자연스럽게 얘기하게 됩니다. 그래서 사실은 이제 많은 사람들하고 얘기를 하다 보면은 전체적인 과학의 흐름 같은 거를 보게 되는데 그러면서 제가 사실 그 혼조하고 앨리슨이 이제 면역 그 관문 억제제로 받을 거다. 그리고 리처드 헨더슨이 크라이오 EM으로 받을 거다. 그리고 오수미 박사님이 받을 거다라고 얘기를 했었고 그리고 빌 케일린 박사님이 받을 거다라는 얘기를 했었는데 그거는 한 50%의 지분은 저의 아주 절친인 샌드라 리엄 교수님이 가지십니다. 왜냐하면 작년에 저희가 막 얘기하다가 빌 케일린이 그 라스커 어워드를 받았는데 곧 노벨상 받지 않겠느냐라고 해서 그럴 거라고 저도 이제 당연히 받을 거다라고 얘기를 하고 그랬었는데 그랬더니 이 친구가 제가 그동안 한 3년 동안 하지 않았던 걸 얘기를 하는데 아 그러면 노벨상 받기 전에 반드시 초청을 먼저 해야지라고 이제 하시는 거예요. 그래가지고 맞다 빨리 초청해야지라고 해서 노벨상 받기 전에 이제 초청을 하면서 이메일이 그랬었어요. 뭐 그 아마도 스웨덴에서 연락을 받겠지만 혹은 나는 당신이 정말 연락을 받기를 바라지만 그래도 11월에 오실 수 있겠느냐라고 했는데 흔쾌히 와주신다고 하셨고요. 더더욱이나 놀라운 건 진짜 받으신 거예요. 이걸 어떡하지? 안 오시면 그것도 가장 바쁜 때잖아. 바쁜 때인데 제가 다시 이메일을 보내면서 당연히 맨 처음에는 축하한다는 말씀을 먼저 전하고 그리고 11월에 여전히 오시겠느냐라고 했을 때 약속은 당연히 지키신다는 말씀을 해주시고 이 자리에 오셨습니다. 그래서 윌리엄 켈리 박사님께 감사드립니다. 네. 네, 한국에는 그러니까 이 나라에는 오랜 전통에 있는데 귀한 손님이 오시면 사실은 이제 선물을 하는데 그 중에 굉장히 좋은 선물은 뭐냐면 도장입니다. 그래서 그 카오스재단에서 오늘 그 노벨상 수상자로서 시상식 전에 오신 윌리엄 케일린 박사님께 선물을 준비했는데 제가 알기로 도장이에요. 굉장히 귀한 도장인 거로 알고 있는데요. 이거를 전달해 드리는 영광을 제가 누리겠습니다.
Thank you. Yeah, yeah.
이걸 좀 감사합니다. 저는 사실은 뭐 영어를 그렇게 잘하는 건 아니지만 영어로 하는 거는 막 그 수다를 떨듯이 하는데 한국말로 하고 영어로 들으면서 또 한국말로 하고 이런 가장 난제 제가 보기에는 빌 케일린 박사님보다 제가 더 힘들 것 같은데요. 20분 동안 그걸 오늘 좀 해보도록 하겠습니다. 자 사실 그 궁금한 점이 많은데 강연을 20분 동안 해주셨기 때문에 일단 그 사이언스에 대한 부분을 먼저 좀 질문을 해드리고 싶은데 제가 사실 많은 그 노벨상 수상자도 만나고 과학자들도 많이 만났는데 노벨상 수상자 중에서 사실은 임상의 관찰에서 어떤 한 현상을 발견을 하고 신장암에서 그리고 그 다음에 그것에 대해서 질문을 던져서 연구를 해서 메커니즘을 발견한 다음에 응용까지 해서 어느 정도의 성과까지 거두신 분은 그리 흔치 않은 거로 알고 있어요. 처음부터 시작까지. 그래서 상당히 놀라웠고 제가 이게 이유였습니다. 사실은 라스커 어워드를 받으실 때 당연히 받으실 만하다라는 생각을 했었고 그래서 이제 아마 곧 노벨상을 받으실 거다라는 아주 자연스러운 예측을 했었는데요. 이런 분이 흔하지 않으시죠? 어떠십니까? 그러니까 처음에 그 VHL, 그 von Hippel-Lindau의 그 현상부터 응용까지 가는 게 그리 쉽지 않았을 텐데 어떻게 그게 가능하셨는지 그리고 어떤 게 그 성공을 이끌어 주었다고 생각하시는지 좀
yes.
말씀 부탁드립니다.
Well, thank you. You know, I think that all scientists today, but particularly physician scientists, are under too much pressure to justify what they are doing in terms of application. And I think you see this around the world that often funding agencies and policymakers say, well, we'll support you, but what is it going to do for me in the next 3 to 5 years, which is entirely unrealistic. I think when you're doing science as opposed to doing engineering, you're still trying to gain knowledge and learn the rules, so to speak. And I think real application happens when you finally have accumulated enough new knowledge that you know something can be done that you didn't know could be done before. So one of the things that makes me happy about this prize is that not only am I a physician scientist, but so are Peter Ratcliffe and Greg Semenza. And all of us believe that what you have to do is get the training to do that early basic mechanistic work and then take the road where it takes you. So I hope people do look at this example because this is how real science, as you know, works. And so, for example, I'm a cancer doctor, but now I've helped to develop a new drug for anemia, but that's where the science took us.
아, 네, 굉장히 예, 저기 여러 가지를 생각하게 하는 말씀이었습니다. 아, 또 하나는 사실은 이 연구를 보면은 제가 그 케일린 박사님의 연구는 보면 우아하다고 해야 되나요? 엘리건트한 면이 있어요. 그러니까 굉장히 깔끔하게 그 공기를 통해서만 제공되는 산소가 어떻게 해서 우리 몸에서 감지되고 그리고 이제 항상성은 그러니까 호메오스타시스라는 걸 유지하게 하고 그리고 그게 망가졌을 때 일종의 균형이 깨졌을 때 병을 만드는지의 설명이 너무 깔끔해서 놀랍도록 그 깨끗하거든요. 이게 어떻게 보면 이제 그 교육 받으실 때 성격 혹은 어떤 성향 이런 거 연결되지 않나라는 생각까지 해서 그 원래 백그라운드가 이제 수학하고 화학을 복수 전공하신 거로 알고 있는데 이런 그 저기 배경이 혹시 거기하고 연결되는지 제가 혼자 상상을 해봤었어요. 이제 맞는지 한번 어떻게 생각하시는지 말씀 부탁드립니다.
Yes, so when I was in college, which I'm sad to say was in the 1970s, biology was really in its infancy and was fairly descriptive and there was a lot of memorization and I didn't like studying very much and I certainly didn't like memorizing facts and descriptions and categorizations. And so I liked instead courses like mathematics and chemistry where it was more conceptual and it taught you how to think clearly and it exposed me to ideas. And so I think that was actually very good training. I think I learned a certain rigor learning mathematics and logic and chemistry that helped me when I did become a biologist. And thankfully, by the time I became a biologist, the field was starting to really mature. And now for the first time, we had modern molecular biology at our disposal.
네, 그러면 좀 어렸을 때 얘기가 좀 궁금해지는데요. 어렸을 때 어떤 유년 시절을 보내셨는지 혹은 그 성장 기간에 어떤 분이 가장 큰 영향을 미쳐서 수학, 과학 이런 곳으로 이끌었는지가 상당히 궁금합니다. 혹시 기억나는 분이 계신가요?
Well, like most children, I liked playing more than I liked studying. And so I tended to be, I would say, an average student when I was a very young boy, with the exception of, again, mathematics. I just found math easy, and once I understood the concept or the idea, I never had to study it again, so I liked mathematics. And I thought I was doing okay. I was getting very good grades in math, but sort of so-so grades. But when I was in the fifth grade, I had a teacher who was a nun, because I was in a Catholic school, and we had a class of 50 children in a classroom, if you can believe it. But my nun teacher called my parents and said, your son is capable of doing much better, and he's not applying herself. And she was right. Now, it frankly took a few more years before that actually completely sank in. But later, when I was in high school, I went to a summer camp with some very gifted students, and that kind of opened my eyes that you know, if you're surrounded by really smart people, some of it starts to rub off on you and you start to pick up some of their habits. So all of this is to say I was sort of a late bloomer in school. I didn't really truly start working hard and applying myself until late into high school.
겸손하게 말씀하신 것 같은데 사실 이
I probably shouldn't say that in front of any students that we might have here. But
이 일화가 제가 라스커 어워드 수상하셨을 때 그 비디오를 봤더니 저한테는 상당히 좀 여러 가지 생각하게 하는 거였는데 그 수학을 잘하는 학생 20명을 뽑아서 캠프를 하는데 거기서 이제 사이언스를 하게 됐는데 거기서 이제 옆에 친구들이 똑똑한 친구들하고 같이 있으니까 많이 배우게 되더라라는 이제 면을 말씀하셨어요. 그래서 제가 궁금한 점 이겁니다. 사람들이 다 다르게 생각하는데 이 사이언스에 대한 흥미 이게 고등학교 때 생기는 게 많은 것 같은데요. 고등학교 때 그 트였다고 보십니까? 그 자신에 대해서 아니면은 대학 때 아 내가 아무래도 뭐 메디슨을 하든지 아니면은 과학을 해야겠다라는 생각을 하게 되셨는지 그 경험을 좀 한번 얘기해 주시고 교육이 도대체 어떻게 돼야지 가장 창의적으로 과학자들을 많이 배출하는 교육이 될지 우리 또 이제 젊은이들이 많기 때문에 한번 말씀해 주십시오.
Yes, so I will say a couple of things. So I was born in 1957, which of course was the year of Sputnik. And so especially in the United States, but I suspect it might have been true in Korea, there was a real increase in interest in science and engineering. And so when I was a young boy, I had toys that included a microscope and a chemistry set and other toys that indirectly were introducing you to science and technology. So I think that sort of set the stage in a way. And I would say as a student, I was interested in science, but I thought there was a difference between learning what was already known versus ever being in a position to create new knowledge. I was pretty comfortable I could study and learn science, but especially after that terrible laboratory experience I told you about, I didn't think I would ever create new science and create new knowledge. But later when I got to the Dana-Farber and Harvard and had a wonderful mentor and for the first time a very good lab, I suddenly learn by apprenticeship that I could do science. Your question is a very good one. I still don't know how much of scientific taste you're born with and how much you acquire by virtue of the people around you. I suspect it's a mixture, and I think it's no accident that, you know, I was surrounded by great people at Harvard and I started to learn the way their mind thinks.
예, 자연스럽게 그 데이비드 리빙스턴 박사님, 그 빌 케일린 박사님의 이제 그 스승이시고 멘토이시고 여러 군데서 언급하시는 과학자로서 가장 영향을 많이 미치신 분인데 도대체 그분은 어떻게 케일린 박사님한테 영향을 미치셨는지 혹시 조금이라도 좀 소개를 해주실 수 있을까요?
Yes. So David likewise is a physician scientist and I joined his laboratory in 1988 and I've often said I was either a blank slate when I started or worse given that terrible experience I had. Maybe he first had to erase the slate before he could start writing on the slate. But David, first of all, is a brilliant scientist. He made science fun for me. He made me believe everything I was doing was potentially important. Getting back to our earlier comment, I clearly saw in him that he believed in asking the biggest, most important question he could see and having some courage to do that. And then he was extremely rigorous, very careful, very methodical, and so he left that imprint on me.
네, 역시 신나게 재밌게 하고 아 진짜 너가 진짜 중요한 일을 하는구나라는 걸 이끌어내는 만큼 그 훌륭한 스승은 없는 것 같은데 또 중요한 얘기를 하셨는데 제가 아무리 그 많이 둘러봐도 공통점이 하나 있다면 노벨상 수상자들한테 항상 질문에 대한 얘기를 하세요. 진짜 좋은 질문을 발견을 해야 된다. 질문을 쫓아가야 된다. 이런 얘기를 제가 공부하면서부터 지금까지 진짜 제가 보기에 과학자로서 존경받을 만한 분들은 모두 그렇게 말씀하셨습니다. 그래서 이제 질문을 쫓아가는 거를 이제 하셔서 여기까지 이르렀다는 이제 아주 소중한 말씀을 해주셨는데요. 그러면서 제가 아까 이제 강연 들으면서 뭐 오늘 아침에도 그렇고 그 전에 그 박사님의 연구를 보면서도 생각했었는데 이게 이 산소 감지 HIF1, HIF2도 마찬가지지만 그 경우에요. 많으면 암이 되고 적으면 또 빈혈이 되니까 사실 이거를 조정하는 게 매우 힘들 것 같은데 아까 굉장히 저기 자세하게 들으면 어떤 얘기가 있었냐면 그래서 빈혈 경우는 HIF를 그 안정화시키는 방향을 택하고 암은 HIF를 건드린 게 아니라 그 VEGF라는 그 혈관을 만드는 거를 조정하는 그런 얘기를 하셨는데 1단에서는 HIF1의 수준을 조절을 해서 빈혈과 암 둘 다 잡으려고 하는 일들이 있을 것 같은데 그게 되게 안 될 것 같단 말이에요. 그래서 그 균형을 어떻게 잡아야 되는지 혹시 경험적으로 좀 생각 있으신지요?
Well, I think your question has two components. I think one had to do basically with how do you find a good yeah. question, and then you have a somewhat more yeah. sophisticated question yeah. about yeah. HIF1 and HIF2 yeah. and when do you want to do what. So let's spend a little time on the first question. So first of all, I've tended to work on genes where we know there are mutations or alterations in these genes that are linked to human disease, because that already tells you there's probably some importance to these genes. Secondly, I liked, one of the reasons I went into clinical medicine is I like solving interesting puzzles. And likewise, I think most scientists just like solving interesting puzzles, and why one person finds one puzzle interesting and another person finds another puzzle interesting, that's what makes the world go round. But I did have the benefit that I was starting with genes that I knew were categorically linked to human disease. And I think you heard me say with the students an analogy that when I was young, my father's favorite hobby was to go fishing. And so I learned there were two components to fishing. One was understanding how to fish, like how do you put the bait on the hook? But the other was having good instincts about where to fish. And I would say in my case, one of the best decisions I made was to go fishing on VHL and perhaps not some other place. But I also like the fishing analogy because, as you know, there's some luck involved in this. And so on any given day, a good fisherman might catch no fish, and a beginner fisherman might catch a prize-worthy fish. And so I think any scientist, if they're being honest, would have to admit there's some luck involved in this. And this time we happen to have caught a big, pretty fish, but it didn't have to be a big, pretty fish. So I think, you know, you have to be a little humble when it comes to these prizes. Then you get into, you know, a very sophisticated set of questions about HIF1 versus HIF2. A concern I've heard raised for 20 years now since we first had this idea was that if you stabilize HIF or take a drug that activates HIF, maybe you'll cause cancer, maybe you will cause something that looks like VHL disease. It would take a little while to go over all the molecular explanations for why that's not likely to be true, but all you have to do is think about the fact that, for example, there are a lot of people who live at high altitude, they have high HIF, they make more red blood cells, but they don't develop kidney cancer, and they certainly don't look like von Hippel-Lindau disease. So we now have some molecular explanations, but I think in the interest of the diverse audience, we won't get into the molecular explanations, but we think you can stabilize HIF safely to treat anemia. But for those cancers that really seem to need HIF, we can now also inhibit HIF. So I think we can play both sides.
Yeah, 되게 놀라운 진전이 있었던 것 같은데 진짜 저는 이게 분자 스위치라고 불러도 괜찮을 것 같거든요. VHL과 HIF의 그 상호작용을 그래서 그런 면에서 상당히 재미있습니다. 아, 이 연구를 하시면서 당연히 이거는 이제 오디언스에서도 나올 질문이긴 한데 이게 이렇게 되게 이 분자 스위치의 발견까지 굉장히 재미있는 일들이 가기까지 오늘 이렇게 간단하게 20분 동안 설명해 주시는 동안에 나타나지 않은 게 뭐냐면 힘들었던 순간 아 이거 아무래도 이거 좀 못하겠다 좀 난관이다 도대체 넘어갈 수가 없다라고 해서 힘들었던 순간이 분명히 있었을 것 같은데 혹시 기억나는 순간이 있으세요? 가장 힘들었던 순간이 언제였나요? 이 일을 하시면서요.
Well, first of all, I would say the hardest time I had was that terrible lab experience when I was in college. I'm not sure anything was quite as horrible as that. But I think it's important for everyone to understand, as you well know, that when you do science, not every experiment works. And in fact, sometimes it's when you get an unexpected result that it's the biggest opportunity to learn something new. I always tell people if you only get expected results, then you're not really doing science. You're either doing engineering or you're simply not very creative. So I think a good scientist should actually welcome the occasional unexpected result. You know, we certainly had the usual technical frustrations along the way, and like every other scientist, occasionally our papers were rejected and we had to fight hard to get them published. Occasionally we had our grants rejected and we had to fight hard to get funding. Even the paper that led to the Nobel Prize, when we described this chemical modification on HIF, one of the reviewers said, "This can't be right because this chemical modification has never been seen before inside the cell." Well, of course, that was the whole point. That's why it was so remarkable that no one had seen this before, but it categorically was happening, and this was the switch. And it turned out it was a very elegant solution to the problem we were trying to solve, that nature had used this one chemical flag that already incorporates an oxygen atom. So I think, as you well know, there's frustration, but you know that's tempered with just the joy of the discovery process. And when you have those rare aha moments, it makes up for all of the frustration.
아, 예. 그 힘이 되는 말씀입니다. 저희는 과학자들은 그 한 세 번 거절받고 살짝 한번 즐겁고 뭐 이거의 반복이거든요. 그거를 견디면서 오는데 그 수없이 많은 리젝션의 순간에서도 계속해서 그 앞으로 나아가고 keep on going 한다는 거 이거 이제 굉장히 중요한 건데 소중한 말씀 감사합니다. 사실 이제 제가 이제 재밌는 게 그 저는 그 개인적으로 모토가 어떤 게 있으실지 궁금해요. 그러니까 예를 들어 제가 존경하는 그 과학자 중에 막스 페루치는 I never planned my research, it planned me. 그래서 나는 계획을 해서 목표를 설정하고 연구한 적이 없고 연구가 나를 이끌었다. 그러니까 질문이 계속 나를 이끌었다라는 말씀을 하셨었습니다. 또 같이 이제 공동 수상을 하신 그렉 세만자 같은 경우에는 랩 앞에 아인슈타인의 유명한 말 우리가 하고 있는 것이 무엇인지 안다면 그것은 더 이상 연구가 아닐 것이다 라는 말이 붙어있다고 해서 상당히 이렇게 공감이 가고 마음에 새길 만한 명언이었는데 케일린 박사님께서는 어떤 모토 가지고 계신가요? 연구를 하시면서
Well, my former mentor David Livingston used to say that the key when you're training a young person is to plant them in a fertile area and then occasionally water them a little bit, maybe give them a little fertilizer and let them start growing. And so I must say, once we started working on VHL and began our work, often once we started making some progress, the next question was pretty obvious, and then the next question after that, at least to me, was pretty obvious, assuming you stayed focused and didn't allow yourself to get distracted. And so I think our path was surprisingly linear once we really got started. So and maybe we were lucky in that regard, but we did stay very focused on the question at hand, which was to completely understand the molecular pathway and not to allow ourselves to get distracted by other things. But I completely agree with the principle of the quote, because you don't actually know what the next result is going to be, and hence you don't know where it's going to take you.
네, 사실 제가 그 뭐 이 자리에서 쑥스럽지만 말씀드리자면 빌 케일린 박사님을 존경하는 거는 노벨상을 수상하셔서도 아니고 라스커 어워드를 받으셔서도 아니고요. 사실은 계속 질문을 붙들고 끝까지 가서 답을 얻어내고 그게 상당히 많은 파급을 가지는 그런 연구들을 계속해서 계속해서 하신다는 거거든요. 그래서 어떻게 보면은 접근 방식에 있어서 상당히 배울 점이 많아서인데 이 자리에는 그 과학자를 꿈꾸거나 아니면은 앞날에 어떤 대단한 그 사고라도 칠 수 있는 그 대단한 젊은이들이 많이 와 있고 또 이제 고등학생들도 많이 와 있습니다. 혹시 이 그 자라나는 새로운 세대한테 한 말씀 해주신다면 어떤 말씀을 해주실 수 있을까요? 응원과 격려가 좀 필요한 사람들인 것 같습니다.
Well, I mean, you are the future, and I think the future is bright with so many talented, smart young people. What I would tell you is, if you want to do science, first of all, do it for the right reasons. So, getting back to prizes, I've tried to be pretty consistent in telling people that if you're doing science to win a prize, you should probably stop now, because you're likely to wind up being a very unhappy person, because again, there's some luck involved in winning prizes, and I think they're sort of a false god. I think what you really should ask yourself is, do you enjoy science? Do you enjoy solving puzzles? Do you enjoy seeing data and understanding things that have never been understood before, and participating in that scientific process? And so, you know, what I tell people is, if you ask good questions and you do your science well, meaning you're methodical and you're rigorous and careful, over time you might make a discovery that could lead to a prize, and that would be wonderful. But if you start out saying, I want to win a prize, I think you're going to wind up being unhappy. Because as you said, science can be very frustrating. So you have to really love it. You know, I say that principal investigators, professors, they sometimes do a good job conveying to young people what they don't like about their job. For example, getting a paper rejected. But we don't spend enough time saying what a privilege it is to do our job. I consider it a privilege to come to work every day, where I frankly don't feel like I'm working, I feel like I'm playing. I think I have the best job in the world, and I would come do my job even if I didn't need the money, which is, most people on the planet don't go to work with that mindset. So I think that for the right person, this is the best job in the world, and that's a prize in and of itself to get to do that every day. So, and the last thing I would say is, if you're gonna do this, jump in with both feet and get the training you need to go beyond descriptive work and correlative work, but instead can go deep into mechanism. And that usually requires some training, and it usually requires blending multiple paradigms, such as genetics with biochemistry, to really go deep. So get the training so you can really push the field forward.
네, 제가 그 좀 전에 노벨상을 수상해서 존경한 게 아니다라는 말씀을 드렸지만, 제가 이제까지 이제 계속 노벨상의 수상 현장을 뭐 비디오로 보고 그리고 이제 노벨상 수상자들을 만나면서 느낀 건 뭐냐면, 수상 때까지의 그 노력과 연구에 대한 것도 감동이지만, 실제로는 노벨상 수상자가 어떻게 했다는 게 이 세상에 주는 영향력이 워낙에 커서, 그리고 그게 굉장히 긍정적인 효과를 나타낼 때가 많이 있어서, 그래서 아, 노벨상을 계속해서 매해 주는 것이 인류의 축제구나라는 생각을 최근 들어서 하기 시작했습니다. 그러니까 그전에는 좀 비판적인 시각으로도 좀 보다가요. 그래서 이제 저의 이제 마지막 질문인데, 어려운 질문일 것 같긴 합니다. 이제 노벨상 수상자로서 어떤 그 생활을 하고 싶으십니까? 1번, 예를 들면 연구를 이제까지 하던 대로 계속해서 연구자로서의 길을 가겠다. 2번, 연구를 하면서 일부는 세상에 좀 더 그 보이스를 내서 영향을 끼칠 수 있는 사람이 되겠다. 혹은 3번, 정말로 중요한 그 변화를 이끌어내기 위해서는 내가 아무래도 리더가 돼서 전체적인 구조도 과학을 잘하게 하고 젊은 친구들을 격려하는 데 활용하도록 내가 내 한 몸을 바치겠다. 뭐 이런 예들이 있을 것 같은데 어떤 꿈을 꾸십니까?
Yeah. So this is a question I'm still asking myself, but I will say, as I mentioned in passing, that one of the reasons why we started working on VHL was we thought this would be a so-called Rosetta Stone for understanding kidney cancer, which is a common form of cancer. And I should point out, I found clinical medicine very rewarding and I liked it, but it was clear as a medical oncologist treating cancer patients in the 80s that the only way we were gonna move the field forward was with new knowledge based on genetics, molecular biology, et cetera. And so I could see the revolution was about to happen, and I decided to jump in and try to contribute in any way I could. And so my dream is still to use kidney cancer as sort of a demonstration product, a demonstration project, excuse me, that if you understood this cancer well enough, you could actually cure it with targeted agents. So I'm certainly going to remain pretty focused on trying to demonstrate that it is possible to cure some of the common cancers with targeted agents. But I think there's no doubt, given this new role I think I'm expected to play, that I would like to be an advocate for science, and in particular basic science, and help our non-scientific colleagues, including policymakers, understand the value of basic science. I think that's very important. And if I can help young people in any way, I'd certainly like to do that.
아, 감사합니다. 네, 저의 그 질문은 여기까지 하고 이 오디언스에서 훨씬 더 많은 질문이 있을 것 같습니다. 이제 질문을 좀 받겠습니다. 네, 많은 손을 들어주셨는데 마이크가 가장 가까운 곳부터 갈까요? 그 이쪽, 예.
네, 저 그 이번 연구의 핵심은 VHL과 kidney cancer relationship에 대해서라고 생각하는데요. 교수님의 이번 연구가 다른 암에서도 응용될 수 있을지에 대해 질문드리고 싶습니다.
So, it's not translated.
No, I got it. I got it. Well, as I indicated, now that we know that VHL regulates HIF, and in particular, it turns out HIF2 is the real problem in these kidney cancers, and that HIF2 regulates VEGF. Already we have approved drugs against VEGF being used to treat kidney cancer, and now we have new drugs that target HIF2 that look very promising for kidney cancer. But it's very clear that with any cancer, if you treat the cancer with a single drug, some rare cells within the tumor will be resistant to the drug, and the tumor will eventually escape your treatment. So where we have to get now is to be able to treat kidney cancers with combinations of maybe two or three or four drugs, each of which has a unique mechanism of action. So the chance that any one cancer cell will be resistant to all of the drugs becomes effectively zero. So I've talked about HIF2 inhibitors, I've talked about VEGF inhibitors. We now know that certain drugs that increase the activity of the immune system are very useful in kidney cancer, and we have some newer drug targets in kidney cancer that we didn't talk about today. So I think my goal is to get to combination therapy for kidney cancer, but I think HIF and VEGF will be part of the mix.
Okay, 감사합니다. 예, 가운데 저분.
저 연구원의 삶에 대해서 더 질문을 드리고 싶은데요. 그 연구 분야라는 게 좁고 깊게 연구를 하는 거잖아요. 근데 그 연구 주제를 다른 랩실에서도 같이 연구를 할 텐데 다른 랩실에서 먼저 연구 성과를 낼 수도 있다는 불안감 같은 건 없으셨는지, 있었다면 어떻게 이겨냈는지 여쭤보고 싶습니다.
Practical question.
That's a very practical question. Well, first of all, when we see a scientific question before us, one of the questions we do ask ourselves is this question so obvious, and is the approach to solving it so obvious that it will get solved with or without us? Because if the answer is it's going to get solved with or without us, I'm not that interested in doing that. I don't want to look back on my career and say everything we ever did would have been discovered with or without us. So we try to give a lot of thought as to whether maybe we've seen something that others haven't seen, or maybe we have some particular sophisticated technical expertise that isn't commonly available. So we do ask ourselves these questions. Now, frankly, even when I thought we were so clever that no one else in the entire world would have thought of doing the same experiment, almost invariably there was somebody else doing a similar experiment. So I think it's actually good to operate under the assumption you might have a little competition because that I think is a little extra motivation sometimes to go a little bit faster. Now, sometimes we do lose the race, but fortunately, often we've won the race. But as a scientist once told me, if you lose the race and somebody provides the next piece of the puzzle, you should stand there and thank them, because we're all trying to push the field forward. And so what that means is, okay, they got that piece, so now you'll work on the next piece of the puzzle. And certainly with the work that led to the prize, I know that Peter Radcliffe was sometimes reading our papers and that accelerated his work, but we were reading his papers and that accelerated our work. So I think that's the way science works. So I think being aware that you could have some competition is a good thing, but I do think it's healthy to say, is this so obvious that anybody could do it? Because you want to do things where you have to be a little clever, I think, too, and a little insightful.
네, 저쪽, 예, 저기 번쩍 손든.
Wait, was that which one?
At the back.
In the back. Oh, we're going in the back.
손 흔들고 계신.
The one who's waving. Yes. Okay, back there. Okay.
좋은 강의 감사드립니다. 그 히프라는 단백질에 OH2를 붙이는 효소가 있다면 그것을 혹시 떼주는 효소도 존재하는지가 궁금합니다.
Do you want to come work in my laboratory? We've wondered about that. Now it turns out, at least in the case of HIF, as soon as the OH is added, the HIF gets destroyed within about 3 minutes. So it would be kind of inefficient to put it on and then to try to take it off within the first minute or two. That would seem to be a bit of a waste. But I think more generally, we do wonder whether for other proteins that get hydroxylated, whether there are enzymes that might take the hydroxyl group off. So you can talk to me later about when you're going to start.
네. 네. 저 이쪽 그 레인에서 질문을 받겠습니다. 저 뒤에 맨 뒤에서 손 드신 분이요. 예.
아. 종양 세포가 산소가 없는 상태, 즉 저산소증 상태에서 항암 치료 같은 그런 치료에 대한 저항성을 갖는 원리에 대해서 궁금합니다.
Well, this is, I think, a sort of a
general
question. So we know that with almost any targeted agent against cancer cells, that you run the risk that within the population of cells, and again, many cancer patients have over a billion cancer cells in their body, and sometimes they have 1,000 billion. So there are a lot of cells, and you only need a few cells to have become resistant to the targeted agent. And that could be because those cells have a mutation that prevents the drug from working, just as an example. So we worry about resistance for all targeted agents against cancer. Now, you also raised an issue about hypoxia. It turns out that a lot of conventional chemotherapeutic drugs, meaning from the 60s and 70s, had mechanisms that required, in part, oxygen for them to maximally kill cells. So hypoxia has been known for many years to contribute to resistance to conventional chemotherapy as well as to radiation therapy. So hypoxia is a particular problem when it comes to cancer drug resistance.
네, 제가 사실은 이 아까 시계가 안 보여가지고 제 질문이 과하게 넘었어요. 그래서 죄송하게. 관중의 질문을 제가 시간을 뺏은 것 같아서 죄송합니다. 아, 여기 앞에.
먼저 자극될 수 있는 강의 해주셔서 너무너무 감사합니다. 일단 개인적인 질문 하나 드리고요. 그다음 여기 있는 학생들이 좀 많이 있기 때문에 좀 공통적인 질문으로 두 가지 드리도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 첫 번째로 연구하시는 데 가장 중요한 건 연구 윤리라 생각합니다. 지금 현재 3세대 크리스퍼 가이하고요. 4세대 프라임 에디터가 나왔다고 하는데 그것에 대해서 중국과 러시아에서 지금 대단한 연구들을 진행하고 있는데 많은 과학자들은 그 관점에 대해서 모라토리엄을 선언하고 있거든요. 근데 그것에 대해서 케일린 교수님께서는 어떻게 생각하는지 하나의 질문하고요. 예. 두 번째는 okay, 여기 많은
I'm not sure I understood the fourth.
It's actually about the question on the CRISPR editing being used for the human embryos and
Okay, I'm sorry.
두 번째는 제가 이제 학생들을 많이 저희 학교에 있기 때문에 그런데 저희 학생들이 과학에 대해서 너무너무 어려워하거든요. 근데 교수님께서 공부하시다가 어려우실 때 어떻게 학생들에게 무언가 조언을 해주실 수 있는지에 대해서 제가 두 가지 질문드리도록 하겠습니다. 감사합니다.
Okay, well, the first question, I certainly agree that scientists have to be ethical, moral people, and I don't think anyone is condoning the use of CRISPR to edit germ cells. So I don't think there's any dispute there that that's been routinely criticized in both the lay press and in the scientific press. I think there's no place for doing CRISPR in a form that would affect the so-called germline such that the changes could be transmitted from one generation to the next. So I think that's easy. I think if someone says science is quote unquote too hard when they're in school, then it's not being properly taught. Anything is too hard if you anything is too hard if you go with too much material too quickly, etc. I guarantee if I had enough time with anyone in this room, I could teach them enough molecular biology that they could function well in my laboratory, but I couldn't do it in 24 hours. So I think you have to be a little bit judicious about how quickly you try to teach people and in what order. But that makes me sad to hear that some young people say, well, science is simply too hard. Science should be fun, and I think it can be taught. But sure, you can overwhelm people if you teach it poorly.
네, 제가 사실 마지막 질문 하나 받겠습니다. 요 맨 앞에 학생인 것 같습니다. 고등학생일까요? 예.
Oh, my God.
먼저 그 의사로서 또 생물을 그 연구하시는 분으로서 앞으로 인공 생명 이런 게 생겨나는데 이런 거에 대해서 도덕적인 견해하고 또 그런 거에 대해서 어떻게 생각하시는지 여쭙고 싶습니다.
인공 생명이 혹시 AI하고 결합된 거 말씀하세요? 아니면 조금 더 구체적으로 얘기해 주실 수 있을까요?
좀 더 구체적으로 그 인공지능은 그냥 말 그대로 그 인간이 주입한 정보를 이해하고 그런 거를 그 주입한 것만 대해서 하는데 인공지능은 스스로 인공생명은 스스로 더 다른 우리가 예상한 것과 다르게 스스로 생물처럼 막 움직이는 그런 거를 말하는 것 같습니다.
Do you have any idea?
I'm afraid I'm not qualified to answer that. Question. I mean, the only thing I will say when it comes to AI is I sort of worry sometimes when things are getting so hyped up that it's becoming a little bit unrealistic in terms of the expectations. So I'm sure AI is here to stay. I'm sure AI is very important, but I think we're in a period where we have to figure out what AI can really do. And I'm not an expert enough to really intelligently answer your question.
네, 사실 질문을 닫아야 돼서 이 학생의 질문에 대해서 제가 마무리할 말이 생각나서 그거로 마치겠습니다. 이 과학자들은요, 자신이 답할 수 없는 건 답할 수 없다고 얘기하거든요. 아주 솔직하고 과장해서 얘기하거나 아니면은 책임질 수 없는 답을 하지 않는 특징이 있습니다. 그래서 사회를 합리적으로 이끌고 좋은 사회를 만드는데 과학적 그 합리적 세계관이 그리고 그러한 사고가 굉장히 중요하게 기여한다고 제가 믿고 있었습니다. 근데 지금 마지막 질문에 대한 아주 도전적인 질문에 대해서 케일린 박사님의 답이 그걸 그대로 증명해 주셔서 너무 유쾌한 대담이었습니다. 감사합니다. 자, 그리고 이게 그 저기 케일린 박사님께서 그 노벨상 수상하신 뉴스를 들은 지 한 달 좀 넘었지 않습니까? 그래서 사실 오늘의 이 강연, 특히 이 대중강연이 대중강연으로서는 최초이십니다. 그러니까 세계 최초. 그래서 우리가 그 특권을 누리게 됐었다는 말씀을 꼭 드리고 싶습니다. 헤일리 박사님의 수상을 다시 한번 축하한 의미로 또 크게 박수 한번 치고 끝내도록 하겠습니다.
네, 인상 깊은 강연을 해주신 윌리엄 케일린 교수님, 그리고 즐겁게 대화를 이끌어주신 이현숙 교수님께 다시 한번 박수 보내주시기 바랍니다. 네, 아쉽지만 이제 마칠 시간이 되었습니다. 세 분 교수님께서 이번 노벨상의 성과뿐만이 아니라 그 의미까지 짚어주셔서 노벨상에 한층 더 깊이 다가갈 수 있었던 그런 자리였던 것 같습니다. 아인슈타인의 명언 하나를 대담 중에 우리가 함께 들었습니다. 우리가 하고 있는 것이 무엇인지 정확히 알고 하고 있다면 그것은 이미 연구라 할 수 없다 하는 말을 우리가 같이 들었죠. 연구뿐만 아니라 우리의 인생도 그런 것 같습니다. 알지 못하는 미지의 세계에 대한 질문을 호기심을 가지고 끈질기게 쫓아가다 보면 언젠가 그 질문이 주는 결실을 맛보게 되지 않을까 싶습니다. 질문을 쫓아가다가 이뤄낸 값진 성과들을 보면서 오늘 이 시간이 앞으로 여러분들에게 주어질 질문의 시발점이 되는 시간이 되었기를 바랍니다. 그럼 마지막으로 강연자 세 분을 다시 모시도록 하겠습니다. 자, 오늘 어떠셨나요? 강연에 이렇게 참석해 주신 소감을 마지막으로 좀 여쭤보고 싶습니다. 그러면 먼저 강연 순서대로 박명구 교수님 먼저 한 말씀 하시고 강연 순서대로 한번 해주셨으면 합니다.
아, 예. 과학이라는 게 상당히 재밌는 걸 오늘 많이 들으셨을 텐데 사실은 과학자가 되었을 때 모두가 노벨상을 받는 건 아닙니다. 하지만 과학자가 되면은 그래도 노벨상을 받은 일이 얼마나 멋있는가를 이해할 수 있는 사람이 되는 것도 굉장히 즐거움입니다. 예, 감사합니다.
김영석 교수님.
네, 이런 자리에 불러주셔서 정말 감사드리고요. 그리고 또 여기는 못 오셨지만 또 이렇게 컨트리뷰션을 하신 그 노벨 화학상 받으신 세 분께 정말 감사드리고 축하드린다고 또 전해드리고 싶습니다. 또 그리고 또 이 리튬 이온 전지가 뭐 지금까지 온 거에 대해서는 그 수많은 그 과학자들과 그 엔지니어들과 기술자들도 있거든요. 그분들께도 예 축하드린다고 전하고 싶습니다. 감사합니다.
네, 마지막으로 윌리엄 케일린 교수님.
I was just so impressed with the energy in the room and how engaged people are, understanding that we have a mixed audience and some people more scientific, some people less scientific, but I just felt a very strong sense that people were so engaged and I was very appreciative of that and very moved by that and it made me hopeful about the future of science because we're all in this together.
예, 감사합니다. 네, 저도 세 분을 모시고 또 저와 다른 분야의 과학 업적에 대해서 상세히 들을 수 있어서 즐거운 시간이었습니다. 앞으로도 이렇게 쉽고 재미있는 강연으로 과학의 대중화에 또 힘써 주셨으면 합니다. 그러면 저희는 이렇게 인사드리겠습니다. 앞으로도 카오스 재단과 고등과학원 그리고 기초과학에 많은 관심을 부탁드립니다. 다 같이 고개 숙여 인사드리면서 퇴장하겠습니다. 감사합니다.